Murder at the Seaside, a 1920s cosy mystery, a Tommy and Evelyn Christie mystery, book 8, written by Catherine Coles, narrated by Alex Lee. Chapter 1, Scarborough, North Yorkshire, July 1923. How are you finding Scarborough, Lady Northmore? Lady Caroline Merriweather asked. It's almost too relaxing. Tommy Christie, Earl of Northmore, watched as his wife Evelyn put a hand over her mouth to hide a yawn. It certainly isn't a bit like our last holiday, is it, darling? Goodness me, no, he laughed, and turned back to Lady Caroline, who had arrived at the seaside resort a couple of days earlier, and almost immediately latched on to his great aunt. I'd had the brilliant idea of taking my aunt and my wife to India. That sounds a positively glorious experience. Lady Caroline frowned. I can't imagine what could have gone wrong. It all started when we set off, Evelyn said. Unbeknownst to Tommy, I was in a delicate condition. Tommy smiled adoringly at his wife. I was not aware of Evelyn's condition when I booked the trip. Poor Evelyn was horribly ill all the way to India. I struggled to leave our suite, she said. And Tommy grimaced as he recalled exactly how bilious the trip across the sea had made her. Were you still unwell when you reached firm ground? I'm afraid so. Evelyn sipped her tea. My husband and Aunt Em went off exploring by themselves on the first day, leaving me behind to recover my strength. And when we returned, Aunt Em continued the story, it was to find there had been a murder, and Lady Northmore herself was one of the suspects. Oh, good gracious! Lady Caroline's eyes widened. How perfectly dreadful! Do tell me what happened next. Ordinarily, in those sorts of circumstances, Tommy and I would do a little sleuthing, Evelyn said humbly. We have been fortunate in the past to solve a few cases. I had forgotten about that. Lady Caroline's mouth formed a perfect circle. The hand containing her teacup paused halfway from the saucer to her mouth. The famous Northmore investigators. They are exceedingly well known, Aunt Em bragged. My great-nephew and his wife receive correspondence regularly, simply begging them to solve crimes. Tommy considered his aunt's words not entirely accurate. To date, they had received 3 letters asking for help. One was from a lady who appeared elderly and wanted to track her fiancé, whom she hadn't seen since before the Boer War. Another was from a gentleman in Brighton who believed the spirits of the Bronte siblings occupied his house. The last note was from Ireland and asked for their help in tracking down missing family jewellery. Were you thrown in jail, Lady Northmore? Fortunately not. Evelyn picked up a perfectly cut triangular-shaped sandwich. Lady Emily and my husband worked diligently to solve the crime before it came to that. Aunt Em reached out and patted Evelyn's hand. You did your share, dear. Tell us more about yourself, Lady Caroline, Tommy said. I understand you've known my great aunt for some years. She waved a hand. More than we both care to remember, I am sure. I believe it was around the First Boer War. Aunt Em tapped a finger against her chin. Her mind was usually sharper than a rapier, so it wouldn't be long before she recalled the precise occasion. You stopped receiving visitors. Lady Caroline stared morosely into her empty cup. That was when I lost Charles. You went into mourning, Aunt Em said with feeling. I did. Lady Caroline stared across the road towards the sea. For an exceedingly long time, life lost its fun for me. Fortunately, my children reminded me every day that I needed to go on. Your children were young when they lost their father, Aunt Em commented, with very pretty names, if I recall correctly. Lady Caroline smiled. That's very kind of you to say so. Iris and Violet are wonderful girls. I do hope you don't see it as crass to praise one's own children. Of course, they now have grown children of their own. Tommy wondered what had happened to the family title if Lady Caroline's only children were girls. Had it died with their father, or was it owned by some other long-lost family member? Perhaps that also explained Lady Caroline's retreat from society. She wouldn't be the first gentlewoman to find herself in difficulties financially following the loss of her spouse. It wasn't the first time the ridiculous and archaic system of hereditary titles bothered him. Since he himself had inherited his title in the family home, Heslem Hall, he had felt the unspoken pressure of producing an heir. However, now that Evelyn was close to giving birth, he found himself completely indifferent to whether the baby was a boy or a girl. All he cared about was that Evelyn and his child were healthy. "How time passes," Aunt Em said, as a faraway look came into her eyes. "You should make sure you treasure every moment with your child when it arrives." Lady Caroline looked directly at Evelyn. Over 8 years of marriage told him his wife felt extremely uncomfortable at the intensity of Lady Caroline's gaze, though she answered with her usual graciousness, "You can be certain that I shall." "Do tell me, Lord Northmore," Lady Caroline leaned forward, as though about to impart a secret, "who is the exceedingly attractive man in your party?"
"I am certain that the fellow you refer to is the Earl of Chesden," he said. "He is engaged to be married to my eldest sister, Constance."
"I do so love a wedding. Are the nuptials due to take place soon?"
He couldn't help the frown that puckered his brow. "My sister favours an autumn wedding."
"You don't approve?"
"It isn't that we don't approve," Evelyn said. "Simply that it's all rather sudden, and we haven't had an opportunity of getting to know the Earl very well."
"We didn't know his friend before he married Elise, and that's worked out rather well."
Aunt Em looked at Lady Caroline shrewdly.
"Elise is Tommy's cousin and married to the Earl of Clifford." "Goodness," Lady Caroline lifted her fan and flapped ineffectually at the warm, still air. "Wasn't his father involved in some sort of terrible scandal?"
Tommy glanced quickly at his great aunt as he realised the older woman was deliberately naming their titled relatives and friends. Aunt Em was a lot of things, but ostentatious wasn't one of them. Was it possible she was testing the veracity of Lady Caroline's sudden and intense friendship? It wouldn't be the first time someone had tried to befriend the Christie family because of their connections. Was Caroline Merriweather one of those? Or did she remember her friendship with Aunt Em fondly?
"Mrs. Benson, isn't it?" Evelyn asked, as she approached a woman who appeared to be a similar age to herself. The woman swallowed nervously.
"It is, Lady Northmore. I'm so very pleased to make your acquaintance."
Evelyn nodded at the younger woman sitting with Mrs. Benson.
"Won't you and your sister-in-law come and join us, while the men take port and smoke their ghastly cigars?"
"Oh, we couldn't," Mrs. Benson shook her head. "It wouldn't be right."
"Nonsense," Evelyn said firmly. "What wouldn't be right is for you two to sit here alone when you can sit and chat with us."
"If you're certain it wouldn't be an imposition, how could we refuse?"
Evelyn smiled brightly at the red-haired woman and leaned closer.
"I do hope you won't regret your decision. My sister-in-law is regaling everyone with plans for her wedding. Constance is planning the biggest and best wedding Ireland has ever seen."
"Ireland?" Ruth Benson raised an inquiring eyebrow. "I should love to see Ireland, but my husband Archie tells me the weather is quite inclement."
"It could rain every single day, but I don't think Constance would notice. She's so very much in love."
"That's positively delightful," Ruth replied with a genuine smile. "How wonderful it is to see young people marry for love and not for some misplaced sense of duty."
Evelyn couldn't help but wonder if that had been the case for Ruth and her husband. She had noticed none of the little signs that theirs was a love match. Tommy would chastise her for jumping to conclusions and remind her that not everyone was comfortable showing their feelings in public.
"I completely agree," Evelyn said. "I am pleased to report that the Earl of Cheston is every bit as besotted with Constance as she is with him. My husband, however, is yet to be convinced. As is to be expected, he is very protective of both of his sisters."
Ruth's eyes flicked to the Christie group across the room and then down to the floor.
"Indeed, yes. Is there something amiss, Mrs. Benson?"
"Not at all," the woman replied, but Evelyn wasn't to be deterred.
"Please, speak freely," Evelyn implored, "particularly if it has something to do with my family."
"It's probably nothing at all," Ruth said quickly.
"Why don't you tell me? Perhaps it will relieve your burden to share what you know."
Ruth looked back over at Evelyn's friends and family. Her gaze seemed to be aimed at Tommy's youngest sister.
It's just that I saw Miss Grace talking with the hotel manager this morning.
Evelyn tried to think of a reason the young girl would have to address to the manager of the Majestic, but she couldn't think of a single one. They had brought their nursemaid with them to care for Madeline and David's infant daughter, Josephine, and it was Elsie who liaised directly with the hotel staff.
"That is a little unusual," Evelyn agreed.
"But perhaps she had a particular request to make of him?"
Ruth looked down at the table, and her cheeks flushed.
"Perhaps I should make myself clear."
Evelyn took a seat opposite Mrs. Benson and glanced at Mabel Benson, who was yet to utter a word.
"Please do." "I am not usually an inquisitive person, but on this occasion, I'm afraid I dallied to watch what transpired."
Evelyn wanted to prod the woman into talking plainly about what she had seen, instead of procrastinating.
"I'm sure that is true. And what did you see?"
"It was because he was standing so close to her, you see," Ruth explained. "That's why I didn't move away. He seemed rather too familiar in my eyes."
"We are talking about Mr. Williamson, the hotel manager," Evelyn clarified.
"Yes. Oh, Lady Northmore."
Ruth raised both hands to cover her burning cheeks.
"When he finished whispering in her ear, he kissed her."
Mabel Benson gasped and looked at her sister-in-law in horror.
"The hotel manager kissed Grace?"
Evelyn repeated, unable to hide her shock. She wasn't sure what she was expecting to hear, but it certainly hadn't been that. Grace loved to read romantic novels, but she wasn't as outgoing and confident as her sister. In fact, Tommy's youngest sister was rather shy.
"Are you quite all right, dear?"
Ruth asked Mabel, then turned to Evelyn.
"I'm very sorry, Lady Northmore."
"It isn't nothing at all, is it?"
"It most certainly is not."
Evelyn pressed her lips together in a grim line.
"It is most unseemly. I would be grateful if you can confirm for me where he kissed her."
Ruth Benson flushed again, and Evelyn knew the answer before the other woman spoke.
"It was directly on the mouth, my lady. Lord Northmore will be furious."
Evelyn tapped a finger on the table.
"Can we agree that we should not tell him just yet? Does your husband know?"
"It isn't the sort of thing I would talk to Archie about. I can assure you I will not betray your confidence."
"Good. That is very good. I shall deal with this myself.
We were rather hoping to make this month-long family trip to the seaside an annual event, but we cannot stay here, or indeed plan to return while that scoundrel remains the manager. How dare he presume to lay hands on Grace?"
"I apologize that my words have caused you such distress, Lady Northmore."
Evelyn had never been a snob, but here she was, espousing that a hotel manager was not good enough for her sister-in-law. Not everyone could marry a titled fellow, and nor should they. A troubling thought occurred to her. Was it possible Grace believed herself to be in love with the fellow? Thank you for telling me, Mrs. Benson. I appreciate your honesty and discretion more than you can know. Evelyn smiled at the other woman. Now, please, tell me this. How did Grace react to Mr. Williamson's impertinence? She held her hands to her cheeks, as though she was quite overcome, Ruth explained. I don't think she could believe he had been so bold. Neither could she. And then? Why, the young lady ran hurriedly away, without speaking another word to him. That didn't really inform her one way or the other whether Grace welcomed Mr. Williamson's attentions. Where did this encounter take place? In the hotel gardens this morning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.